Father, we just thank you and pray, God, for this glorious day that you've given us, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your grace and your mercy, God. We just thank you that we can assemble here together because of the men and women who have gone before and given the ultimate sacrifice. Lord, we thank you for the freedoms, God, that we exercise every day. We thank you for this wonderful city that we have, God. We thank you for the blessings over it, the wisdom and the guidance that you've already given us, Father. We just pray that you'll continue to give us wisdom and guidance, God, as we continue on throughout the city's business. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Once again, thank you all for coming out in the inclement weather today to be part of the Lincoln City Commission meeting. If you have not been following, we are going to continue meeting weekly until the end of this month, and then we'll go back to a regular schedule, and that is for the purpose of just making sure that everyone's apprised of business and what we're doing as we're trying to navigate each week as it is different after this disaster that we have encountered. My report today includes, wanted to first of all remind you of some of the items that are coming up. This Saturday, the 17th, we will have Winter Wonderland in our Sharon Sheffield Park. We have a large number of vendors. That should be a great kickoff to the holiday season and get us all thinking maybe in a more positive mode. The Thanksgiving dinner, hometown Thanksgiving, will be held in Sheffield Park on Thanksgiving Day from 2 until 4. We will have Publix is the sponsor for the food. The St. Joe Corporation has also joined this week with a $10,000 donation to help us with some of the amenities such as some music and tents and other items that we'll need for the dinner. So it should be a lot of fun. Everyone is invited. Todd Harradine is going to do a two-hour gospel concert while we're having the Thanksgiving dinner, so we have traditional turkey dressing and all of those great amenities. So I hope everybody will come out and enjoy that. I'm very thankful to St. Joe, as well as another four different individuals donated another $1,800, so we're now at almost $57,000 in our hurricane relief fund. If you've been following on social media, I have been contacting many, many sponsors and worked very hard on that this week. And as I've said before, $40 million is a large ask, but this is a large disaster. There are large needs and our faith is large. So we are going to keep asking, and I am looking for a miracle. I keep thinking of those Hallmark movies and the Lifetime movies where little towns have had a bad thing happen and the whole town is joined together. And before they know it, the miracle happens. So that's what I'm looking for. If you want to keep in mind the $40 million where that figure came from, there are approximately 8,000 homes in our city. And so with that first $40 million, we would be able to grant as a commission checks to each of the homeowners in our city for $5,000 each for the insured, the uninsured, and the underinsured to help them to start the rebuilding process. So that will be a great shot in the arm for this community, so please keep your positive attitudes and your prayers going for that to happen. I did meet with FEMA representatives this week along with the city manager. We spoke with them regarding the trailers and the campers for our city. And if you remember, what we were looking at is allowing residents to park those trailers on their own property and have those trailers there, campers there, as they're building or repairing their homes. And that seems to be the best option for us. And we do know that that is moving forward. There are approximately 102 that have been approved in Lynn Haven at the last report, with 28 of those being homeowners and 72 being renters, and the other two are with insured classification. The problem for the renters is finding a place to put their campers, and so be thinking if any of your neighbors approach you about the idea of maybe allowing to share some of your property with them. And we're going to continue to work on that issue this week. I also met with some other potential donors to our Hurricane Relief Fund. And then on a very personal note this week, sometimes joy comes in small packages. And Ramona, who's the director of our animal shelter, brought a little furry refugee from the storm to me. And so my husband and I adopted him. His name is Buddy. And he is he's a little terrorist, actually. But he's just a cute little beautiful dog. He has lifted this mayor's spirits. If you've never adopted a rescue animal from a shelter, I would encourage you to do so. They are really cool creatures. And with that, I'll turn it over to Commissioner Tender.
Thank you. Actually, I don't have a report this week. It's just very stable, taking phone calls.
Just day to day. Lots of phone calls.
Yes, thank you.
Commissioner Russell.
Thank you, Mayor. I just want to let everybody know that I'm still amazed at the Lynn Haven citizens and the employees of Lynn Haven. Every day somebody comes up to me and talks about something the city employees have done or a neighbor has done that's helped them. It's just a great community and I'm glad to be a part of it. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you. And I just remember since the seat is empty next to me, before I get the next commissioner's report, I need a motion, please, to excuse Commissioner Barnes from today's meeting. He said he had something come up at the school where he works that he couldn't get away.
So moved.
There's been a motion and a second. Any discussion from the board? Any discussion from the public? Mr. White, would you call the roll for approval?
Commissioner Russell?
Yes.
Commissioner Freeman?
Yes.
Commissioner Tender?
Yes.
Mayor Anderson?
Yes. And so I will excuse Commissioner Barnes from absence today. Commissioner Freeman?
Thank you, Mayor. Yeah, just real quick, I agree with Commissioner Russell. I just at lunch today, I got another compliment on how the city's doing. It does seem like every day I get somebody reaching out somehow, complimenting on how the city's doing. It's really an honor to be a part of the team. Even the little bit that I may be doing, it's just an honor to be a part of the team. And then also, kind of my theme for it seems like I have a theme every week. My theme this week has been trash, so I'm looking forward to 14 today on today's agenda. So everybody's wanting to know about the next stage and for the trash. So, and that's all I have. Thank you, Mayor.
Amen. Moving on to item number 5 would be the city manager's report. And before he begins his report, I just wanted to reiterate again how pleased that I am that Michael White is our city manager at this time during this particular time in our city's history. Could not be a better person at a better time to do the things he's doing. He's got a can-do attitude. He is very respectful of all the employees and their time, their losses, the sensitivities. I just wanted to say that I'm very proud to be the mayor to sit next to Michael White as the city manager.
Thank you, Mayor. Everything's been going pretty well. We're still trying to remove a lot of debris from the city. I've brought on 4 more trucks, so that should help us move a lot more debris out of the city. There are some things on the agenda today that the commission will discuss about C&D. We've been getting a lot of calls about when the sheetrock, the insulation, everything out of my house getting up. Well, today, that will be discussed and voted on to turn these contractors loose to start removing some of that debris from the city. I have sent out some letters to the state trying to ask for some funding, preliminary bridge funding for the city to help with some of these invoices when they come in. World Plane, the public adjuster, has been working hard with the insurance company trying to figure out what we're going to do with all the facilities in the city that are damaged. Some of them are total losses, some of them have a lot of renovation. So I expect I will have to be getting more containers, trying to put what little we can salvage on some facilities in there. Also, we're still working on plans for the future, so we'll continue looking at that. The city's running pretty good. I got a great staff, and I appreciate everything they've done. And I think Pasco has moved out for Rick Matt. So they have left one of their buses for us to utilize for part of the PD, and we hope to have a trailer in place tomorrow or the next day to try to help us get a little a place called home a little bit for the PD and where the officers can do their reports and things of that nature. So with that, I appreciate all the support of the commission.
Thank you. Number 6 will be our attorney's report.
No report.
Thank you. And then item number 7 is public commentary. This is an opportunity for anyone in the audience who would like to speak on any topic to come forward and speak. It can be on the agenda or it may not be on the agenda. So the floor is open if you just come to the microphone. Yes, sir. Come on down.
My name is Brad Hunt, 210 Lakeview Terrace. And my hot button issue is with the building codes. I think Hurricane Michael has proven that the building codes for Bay County and for Northwest Florida in general were not adequate. The evidence of that is on the curb of every street in the city. I think it's incontrovertible. Upon thinking about it, the biggest error, I believe, is the design wind speed. It's set for 125 miles an hour. We grossly exceeded that during the hurricane. And I think that the building code needs to be revised. If we wanted to take an easy path, we would adopt the building code of a county like Collier County or perhaps Broward County. Just adopt their building code wholesale, and we'd have nice, strong buildings. We are about to embark upon a $300 million repair effort for the homes in Lynn Haven. And when you do a $300 million repair effort, and you're doing it to the same darn code that's been proven inadequate, that is absolutely the wrong way to go. What I think needs to happen is an ordinance raising the building standard before all these repairs go into place. In some cases on a roof, it may be the difference between 6 nails rather than 4, perhaps a little bit of additional roofing cement. If you have a code and ordinance clause provided in your insurance policy, the insurance company will pay for it. So I'm urging the city commission to consider elevating the building standards before all the rebuilding occurs. Thank you.
Thank you so much. My only comment to that, I certainly agree that the winds were far above that, and obviously as we look at building new city buildings, we'll be looking at words like safe room, shelter, that kind of thing, to not only qualify for funding, but to make it safe for our residents. But the issue with an ordinance at this point in time is that the rebuilding and the repairs have already begun. I'm not the lawyer, I don't understand how that can be done in a quick way, or if it is the right thing to do when people are already in progress, trying to put a roof over their heads. That's my first gut reaction to what you're saying. The logic of what you're saying, I'm totally on board with. But as far as the logistics, that's when people have already begun rebuilding and in progress, I don't know that the ordinance would be the answer, but that's just my thought. Anyone else?
Yeah, just like Governor Brad is, my staff and I have already started discussing that. And that's definitely something that's going to be taken up. Unfortunately, right now, like the mayor did say, there's a lot of building going on because there's hundreds of permits being pulled every day. I don't know how that would choke and stifle repair, but I do agree with you. I think we really need to look at that, and I intend to.
Anyone else?
Oh,
sorry. Mr.
Frank? Yes, Mayor,
if
you don't mind. I think it's an excellent idea. The only thing, I think that you would handle that, and of course the lawyer would know better as well, but you just have a start and stop date for the ordinance. But while we're speaking about it, city managers just maybe take this away. I understand the insurance part, but I would want the ordinance maybe to include that if they don't have insurance for some reason, I wouldn't want to impose any additional hardship during the regional. Is my thought. That's all. Right. Thank you.
Is there anyone else like to speak on any other topic or the same topic? Go ahead. Self-contained to the point that they do have tanks which have to be emptied at some point. There are trucks available to do that. It is possible with the proper equipment that you could just feed the campers waste materials into the sewer clean out on your own property if you were doing that. They do have water tanks. They are pretty much self-contained. The smaller campers like FEMA is purchasing right now, most of those are set up for normal electricity that can be plugged into just the ones at 120 volts. So they are pretty much self-contained. where you may be going with that is if people have these trailers on the property, they would have to adhere to certain, you know, standards, just like they would in a campground, so they're not infringing upon neighbors' rights with water and sewer and that kind of thing.
I have a neighbor whose home is obviously 80% destroyed, and he works in Panama City. Cannot live in his home. He's living with his mother and presses. So every morning he's coming to Panama City, working a full day, and then going home to Crestview. If he were able to have a trailer on his property, it would make it more convenient for him to oversee some fix up on the
yes.
property. How would he get his name on the list for something like this?
There is not a list or a trailer RV on your property at this point in time. What we agreed upon was that you would get a permit from the city. There's no charge for the permits, just so that we know where they're located when the time comes for us to have them removed or to ask people to move them months down the road. As far as being on the list with FEMA to apply for individual housing assistance, what that's called, there have been over 100 people in Haven that have been approved for FEMA to pay for the campers. That goes through the FEMA process. You sign up for FEMA for the and as you sign up, you ask for individual housing assistance, and then that process leads you to being funded or not. But people are certainly able, there are many people right now in Long Haven who have gone and purchased campers or who are in the process of doing that on their own and were not approved by FEMA.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Anyone else have a question? Comment? Yes, sir?
Just a public comment?
Yes.
Okay.
Hi, y'all. I'm Rob Jackson, 1818 Country Club Drive, I'm here in Florida. Listen, just a couple quick things. First off, I want to tell you guys thank you for the hard work you've done and the job you've done as the administrator. Can you hear me okay? I ran into you. Anyway, thanks for the hard work you guys have done. I know that it's often a thankless job, especially in a crisis like this, and I imagine that now the thanks are starting to get worn off since people upset. So I want to say thank you to you guys and the administrative staff for all the hard work you guys have done. The second thing is my wife and I have a ton trying to figure out what to do to help people where we can. And one of the things that I think is appropriate is the employees of the city. So my wife and I would like to double the amount of the award that you guys give out to the employee of the month and the supervisor of the quarter for the rest of the fiscal year. That's okay with you all?
I think that is a very generous, kind offer. Thank you very much.
And so I'll jam some paperwork and I'll get it to the city manager and go from there.
Thank you, Rob.
Yeah, very kind. Thank you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you guys. Seriously.
That's very kind.
Thank you, Rob.
We all thank you.
Yeah.
Is there anyone else? And the spirit of generosity lives on. Anyone else? Okay, I think that brings us to the end of public commentary. Number 8 is a public hearing. This is the final reading of Ordinance Number 1068, the Small Scale Future Land Use Map Amendment, SSA-18-7. This is low density residential area to mixed use, and this item will come up for a vote on item number 10. At this time, this is a public hearing. Let me check my clock, sorry. It is 2:20 Central Time. And Mr. White, if you would please read Ordinance 1068.
Ordinance number 1068, an ordinance provided for the adoption pursuant to Chapter 163 Florida statutes for the land use change from low density residential to mixed use for an approximately 7.2 acre property located west of Highway 389 across from Aberdeen Parkway, parcel number 11536-000-000. And the City of Lynn Haven, Bay County, Florida, repealing all ordinances in conflict herewith and providing an effective date.
Thank you. Are there any comments from the board on this item or questions? Are there any comments from the public or questions? Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry, I just left you standing there.
No, that's okay. It's a public hearing. They normally just need to get something, but if you, I don't need to, it's up to you.
I'll go ahead and take Mrs. Walker's comments and then we'll go from there.
If I could find out exactly where we're speaking
about, so I'll just go ahead and let Mr. Richard give you the information as he graduates. Okay.
Commissioner Russell?
Yes.
Commissioner Fran?
Yes.
Commissioner Tender?
Yes.
Mayor Anderson?
Yes. The minutes are approved. There is no old business to discuss. New business is the approval. This is item number 10. This is the parcel we were just discussing in the public hearing. The approval of ordinance number 1068, small scale land use map amendment, SSA-18-7, from low density residential to mixed use. And I would ask legal counsel, there's no reason for me to read the ordinance again since we just did it in public hearing, isn't it? Thank you. Is there a motion for approval?
So moved.
Second.
There's a motion and a second for approval. Any discussion from the board? Any further discussion? Any from the public? There appears to be none. Mr. White, would you please call the roll?
Commissioner Russell?
Yes.
Commissioner Friend?
Yes.
Commissioner Tender?
Yes.
Mayor Anderson?
Yes. So the ordinance would stand approved. Item number 11, approval of the final plat. Approval of final plat for the subdivision known as Cameron's Crossing Phase 2. Is there a report for this information, Mr. White?
This is a request for final plat approval of the subdivision being constructed on parcel numbers 11515-060-000. 11515-070-000 and 11515-090-000. It consists of 24.49 acres and the preliminary plat was approved by the City Commission in 2016. This plat has reduced side setbacks of 6 feet, which were approved by the Board of Adjustments in October of 2017, and the subdivision will consist of 57 single family homes and supporting infrastructure.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Is there a motion for approval?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
There's been a motion and a second for approval. Are there any questions or concerns from the commission? Are there any from the public? Yes, sir.
My name is Brad Hunt, 210 Lakeview Terrace. I live in a subdivision where some of the homes have backyard to backyard you know, because you have two streets in the subdivision, there is a drainage swale running between the backyards. The lot line is in the middle of that swale, and everybody's built fences because they have dogs, because they have pools, because they have kids. The state, however, regards the homeowner association as being responsible for the integrity of the swale. If the swale is not working, the homeowner association has no ability to rectify the situation. Nonetheless, the HOA is responsible for it. I see the same problem being possible with Cameron Crossing Phase 2. Once again, you have a backyard-to-backyard situation. Once again, you have a drainage easement in those backyards. Once again, the lot line is in the middle of that drainage easement. Now, what caused the problem in the Meadows is you had the developer and the engineer working to establish the grade, and then you sold off the lots to individual builders, each of whom regraded their lot, and thereby losing the original grade for the swale. So you had a situation where it could not possibly succeed, and you knew at the outset that it would not succeed. My attitude as a professional engineer is that this is a foreseeable problem, and that merely meeting the state code which permits swales is not adequate. It is a dereliction of duty to fail to anticipate this problem. And I would like to suggest that there be a pipe, drain pipe, rather than a drainage swale between those backyard to backyard type situations. That's my comment.
I tend to agree with what Ms. Brad is saying. I mean, it makes sense, but where does our responsibility lie about this?
Chris, can you answer that phone quick?
So it's Chris Forehand with Panhandle Engineering. He is a consultant to the city.
Chris Warden, on this particular development, I know what this gentleman's referring to. In the Meadows, they had swales that are on the very back of the lots, and right, the fences are off in the center. But on Cameron's Crossing, they didn't have stormwater easement. The fences cannot be within that easement, so the HOA has to maintain it. So the backyard stops before you get to the swale.
Any further comments or questions? Mr. White, would you please call the roll?
Commissioner Russell?
Yes.
Commissioner Franz?
Yes.
Commissioner Tender?
Yes.
Mayor Anderson?
Yes. Item number 12 is the approval of a commission meeting. I'm sorry, let's go back to item number 11. With those votes, that stands approved. Item number 12 is the approval of commission meeting dates for December the 4th and the 11th. Mr. White, would you comment on those dates, please?
Yes, ma'am. And also, one thing that was inadvertently left out as we tried to put something together this week for this commission meeting and also our employees' Thanksgiving dinner. So what I would like to propose, we only have meetings the rest of the year on November 27th, December 4th, and December 11th. The last three meetings for this year.
And my only question would be, as far as the 11th, is there a reason why it would be the 11th and not the 18th? Would you be the final vote?
No, ma'am, and there's not, but it's totally up. I didn't know. We didn't know if any of y'all was doing vacation.
I got it, and that's kind of what I was thinking, and I'm certainly not against the suggestion. It would just mean there would be, really there would be 3 weeks there. And so I'm thinking that maybe we need to go for the 4th and the 18th. Is there any other question or discussion? That's just my suggestion, so please chime in.
Right. I'm fine with it too, by the way, and I don't know that the dates matter to me at this point.
Why don't we, this would be my suggestion, that we go with what Mr. White suggested, the 27th, even though that's not on the agenda, but the 27th, the 4th, and then on the 4th, we can leave open to decide whether we need an additional meeting in December at that point. I mean,
that works.
We don't need to have a meeting just to have a meeting if there's not something on the agenda. So that would be my thought, is that...
I just wanted to comment that there were two accidents in the paper last week, one for Andrew's Plantation final plan, and two Finch park zones, the development order, and also the preliminary plat that had been public notice to be heard on the 20th.
The 20th of November,
next week.
So we would definitely need to meet on that day?
Yes.
Thank you for bringing that to us.
Thank you for bringing it to us. We are having our Thanksgiving dinner on the 20th. Could we possibly move the time on the 20th?
If the time advertises the same.
If the timing tells me to handle it, I'll be happy to handle it. So, like, amend the ad that was in last week to change it. That's something that we can do either the day or the time. I just wanted to let you know that that had been public notice.
I have to avoid confusion. I'll just say that we renotice and cancel that hearing, or we have it as the time exists. If we move the time, I don't want to answer that. It came at the old time, and it creates a lot of confusion. So we either cancel it.
That we have a commission meeting on the 27th, December 4th, and with a decision made on the final meeting in December only if we need one.
Second.
Well, I didn't make
that. I understand. Move approval as presented by the mayor.
Thank you.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Any comments or objections from the public? Mr. White, would you call the roll, please?
Commissioner Freeman?
Yes.
Commissioner Russell?
Yes.
Commissioner Tender?
Yes.
Mayor Anderson?
Yes. Thank you. Okay, moving to item number 13, the approval of subaward agreement number 2018-R03 between Bay County and the City of Harbor Water. The final, that would include paving, new restrooms, and some other improvements there. And those funds have finally made it all the way through the Treasury Department and back to the County Commission, and they're finally available to us. And they'll be in excess of $400,000. So that's going to be a great shot in the arm to Porter Park. So does anyone else have information or have a report on this particular item before I ask for a motion? Is there a motion for approval?
Second.
There's been a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Other than hooray? Okay. All right, Mr. White, would you please call the roll?
Commissioner Cram?
Yes.
Commissioner Russell?
Yes.
Commissioner Tender?
Yes.
Mayor Avery?
Yes. So excited. Good news for Lynnhaven. Item number 14 is the authority to approve addendum number 2 to the contract for RMP 1213-2 for Ashford Incorporated and or Crowder Gulf for disaster debris removal and disposal services using the same rate as the county for C&D compaction materials and release the second phase of the contract to pick up C&D materials. And before I ask for a motion and a second to approve, I would like Mr. White, just for the edification of anyone in the audience who does not understand the pickup process, because the push, pickup, haul, and chip and all those processes are confusing to those of us who've not been through it before. And this is going to move us into the second phase, as many of you are concerned about the construction debris inside the road.
Yes, ma'am. As everyone knows, the first phase to get the city cleaned up was the push. We had a couple contractors in here, Crowder Gulf still being one of them, that helped us push and get a lot of the debris off the side of the road and in the middle of the road to the sides. The next thing we done was we opened up a contract for this stuff, the tree limbs and the debris, the vegetation to be picked up on the side of the road. They are still making a push on the first phase. The issues become is as they get everything on the side of the road, finally everybody's using a chainsaw and putting stuff back out on the road. So it's slowing down the process some, but that's fine. We're going to get it all out of the city. The next phase is they haul to a EMS site where it is being chipped. And then it will finally go to a rescue place in someone's pit, you know, here in Bay County. This particular C&D is, if you think of any material that is torn out of a home or any material that's put on the side of the road with the exclusion of white appliances, things like refrigerators, you know, washers, dryers, deep freezers, things of that nature, it's not included in this. That has to go handle a special particular way. So, what I'm suggesting to the commission, allow the mayor to execute today, is to allow the C&D and let's move forward. We'll let Crowder and Ashford be able to pick, start picking this up and clean your city up and try to get the smell and give, make everybody a little happier.
Is there a motion for approval?
So moved.
Second.
There's been a motion and a second. Any questions or discussion from the commission? Any questions or discussion from the public? There appears to be none. So, Mr. White, would you call the roll?
Commissioner Fram?
Yes.
Commissioner Russell?
Yes.
Commissioner Tender?
Yes.
Mayor Andrew?
Yes. So that brings us to item number 15, which will be the adjournment of the meeting. And before I do that, I just want one more time to thank the Lynn Haven residents who have been so patient and so kind to each other, who've worked well with each other. I'd like to thank the city employees again for all that they've done to keep the city running, and for this commission for the wonderful, agreeable meetings that we've had, as we've had to reach very quick decisions, sometimes very important decisions. So thank you, everybody. And the meeting is adjourned.